So I think that everyone has some experience, especially after swimming, water is trapped in the ear canal. And then what you do is try to shake the head or jump up and down to get rid of the water trapped in the ear canal.
Every human, the size of ear canal and length of ear canal is different depending on the age. So especially for small kids, has a small diameter.
You can think about, you have a straw. One is big straw, one is a small straw. You have a, let's say, the water or coffee is sticking inside. Big straw is easy. You can get rid of the water. But the small straw, you need to shake a lot to get rid of the water out. Same principle. The small kid need more acceleration to remove the water trapped in the ear canal. We measured how much acceleration is needed, which is about 10 times gravity, which is a similar acceleration soccer player can feel when they're heading the ball.
Usually medical doctors are recommend to remove the water using some vinegar or alcohol or using hair dryer.
Don't shake head. That's a one sentence conclusion. Don't shake your head.
According to some literature, if there is no side vent, cyclists can expend up to 90% of their energy overcoming drag forces. If a cyclist is riding without the presence of any wind, the wind direction that they see because of moving is in the same direction as their motion. But as soon as there is a side wind, that apparent wind changes and they see the wind coming from a different direction. What we've been looking at is how we can position a second cyclist different locations to minimize the forces acting on that second cyclist. I had two senior students, Adam Lovell and Alec Cunningham, work with me on this project. They were seniors last year and they were also on the cycling team, so they had plenty of cycling experience. We had small-scale experiments in a wind tunnel. One interesting thing that we discovered was that the first cyclist benefits from the other cyclist behind him, and the forces acting on him are slightly decreased compared to if he or she were to ride along. And then the fourth cyclist, or the last cyclist in our configuration, seemed to have larger forces acting on him compared to the second and third. And you can think of this as a train. The front will experience a lot of the drag. Back will experience some of the drag as well because of a low pressure region behind it. But then the cars in between are shielded by the rest of the train. And they still experience drag and friction, but not as much. So in the middle.
Sails are very special kind of wings, very thin. So the flow struggles to go around the sail. Typically, if you're imagining an airplane, the flow is very smooth and goes around the foil very easily. And that generates lift, but on the sails it doesn't. So that's what fascinated me. When the flow hit the sails, it actually start rolling over into vortices. And what really generates the lift are these vortices. So we put a sail inside the water and we measure the flow velocity around the sails. And in this way, we could finally see the same vortices that we could see with numerical simulations. We have discovered recently that if we exploit correctly a vortex which is generated near the leading edge of the sails, then this vortex can generate a significant increase of sail performance. So my research for the future years is to understand how I can actually keep the vortex in the position where I want, to have the form and the strength that I want in order to make the boat go faster.